So for those of you who don't know me, I've not even got my badge on. I'll at least put my badge on for the day. It says right here, Alisdair Meredith. I am the recently retired Library Working Group Chair for the C++ Standard Committee. Marshall Clare, who I'm sure many of you do know, has just taken over from me as of last week at the previous meeting. So I'm free, but I'm still not doing a happy dance. And topic for the subject today. When I set out to write this about 6 months ago, I'd got two or three ideas in mind about little corners of the standard library that weren't immediately obvious to people, but struck me as useful things to share. Largely the wisdom that I learned from the previous chair to me, Howard Hinnant, who has lots of little important observations when you start getting down to the nitty-gritty of implementing a standard library. And I presume that I was naturally going to roll out another dozen more. That didn't quite happen. So what we have is much more a focus, turning to my collected folk wisdom of the things I learned about preparing standard libraries, or my own homebrew implementation and shepherding through on the standards committee, the kind of questions about the design that come up, and just the good design principles I think we've distilled, all the quick questions to think about that you when you're designing a library for a broader audience. So it's specifically not going to be a study in template metaprogramming that many folks assume you will get every time you start looking at the standard library. There's many other places at this conference you can learn about that. Likewise, I'm not going to make continuous references to allocators that do seem to pepper a lot of the contentious parts of the library. I have a separate talk about that. You can find that online. But I will say, if you are interested in template metaprogramming, implementing allocator traits is about the best way I know to learn all the current set of tricks and techniques that we're using. It's an entertaining prospect. So the key lesson I learned as I was preparing all this and figuring out which details mattered to me is that documentation is of vital importance to any successful library. And I presume we all know this, but it's that thing that we always like to leave to last, because it's always more fun to write code and make something work than actually document what you've done. But if you want people to use your library, if they can't find out about it, if they don't know how to use it, if you have no documentation, you're going to have essentially no users, or you're solving a really interesting problem that people will rip apart your code to figure out what it is they're doing, and hopefully you've done it well enough that that's easier than them implementing themselves. So documentation is pretty much the key. And the important part of the documentation, it turned out for me, is the contracts. Your contract between you as the implementer and the user, what they can expect from your library. This is the heart of your interaction with your end users. So most of what I'm going to talk about for the rest of the presentation is subtle aspects of contracts that there's sometimes implicit contracts or in the standard library, or contracts that don't seem so well documented because they're in a piece of common documentation somewhere else. So you often might miss some of the subtleties of contracts. But these are the issues about when your documentation is complete, when your contract is complete, that seem to be the heart of the lesson I learned while I was going through this presentation. General principles on documentation, so good naming of classes, functions. This gives you readable code, but it's not a substitute for the documentation, because as your use evolves, some different people have different ideas what words mean. The documentation of the contract is the key. But likewise, good documentation is not an excuse for bad names. People do want to have good readable code as a consequence.
Yes.
So hopefully motherhood and apple pie. But yeah, my key lesson, documentation is the contract. At this point, I'm pretty much reading through my slides because I'm suffering a little bit still with the altitude and being early, but I'll warm up shortly. But yeah, key issue is it tells the user their responsibilities in calling your function. So this is the notion of preconditions. If your preconditions aren't satisfied, then you're not in a position you can call that function, and the user needs to know it's their bug, not your bug, that they called you out of contract. Likewise, we describe the library's responsibility to say, if you do call us within contract, we tell you what you call us correctly, what you get when we fulfill the contract, what return value you get, how we're going to change the state of the system. Things you can rely on as a consequence of calling the function. And some of these seem obvious, and some of these are subtleties that we'll see in a couple of slides. Key issue for me with the contract is, when a bug turns up in code, we enter a negotiation. Is the bug in my code or is the bug in yours? And if my contract has given me a clear description, then clearly the bug is in your code. If the bug is in my code, we could just argue that I badly documented my contract, but then do I fix a contract or do I fix a code? Example coming up shortly. Key question is, what happens if a contract is violated? A variety of options here. We have, who thinks undefined behavior is the right choice when a contract is violated? We just declare it undefined and that's that. Okay, this is where we're getting a bit of audience participation, sorry. I'm seeing about 10-15% of the hands going up. Who thinks throwing an exception is the right response to calling out a contract, sorry? I'm probably seeing about 20% of the hands going up. Who believes just straight terminate the program is the right response to calling out a contract, sorry? Probably about 25% of hands. Log and return. I'm seeing a couple of hands going up on that one as well. So,
all of the above.
All of the above is a good answer. My argument here, general observation, I know John's got whole talks on this. Ultimately, the library author is going to choose how they're going to support their customer. And they're going to decide what their response to you calling out a contract is. My preference, is what I do a lot at Bloomberg, is we have an assertion handler, so the user who's calling the library can install their own callback to say that the library consumer gets the choice. And any of those policies, apart from undefined behavior, are reasonable at that point. Undefined behavior is how the library caller should consider what's happening. So this is the first line is still a very good way as a library consumer to think about the issue. But this is not undefined behavior in the compiler sense where all bets are off. The library vendor can do something to help me, but that also includes they could just let your code go straight through and actually call hard compiler undefined behavior. So you have no expectations other than if a library vendor supplies something that you can help you out along the way. John?
Log and return is really a valid option.
Unfortunately, it's one we actually use at Bloomberg.
We use it to debug stuff, we don't use it in production.
I don't think we want to have that discussion up front now, but we don't, but I'm afraid it occurs. Repeat the question. Was suggested that log and return is not actually a reasonable option, and my point was that I have existing experience of customers of our system who are doing exactly that with the assertion handler that we install. So for some folks, being able to log the bug and continue running and trying to keep the system up and live even with the error can outweigh a lot of the other considerations here. Hopefully they will at least understand that maybe it's time to try to bring the system down in an orderly fashion. So I'm going to introduce a piece of vocabulary now. It's been John introduced this for some discussions on the standard committee about 4 or 5 years ago, and it's hopefully becoming into a bit more widely recognized now. But look, if it's a narrow or a wide contract, and it again comes down to those preconditions on the caller. A wide contract is very simply a contract on a function or some part of the system that I can call that has absolutely no preconditions. So whenever I call it, however I call it, it's always valid from the library user's point of view. Conversely, a narrow contract simply says there are some preconditions. A single precondition is enough to say I have to be aware when I call this function that I, as a consumer of the library, have some kind of responsibility. So question is, which is better? Well, generally speaking, consumers like their nice wide contracts because they don't need to think about calling things. But unfortunately, that means you possibly have to have a wider variety of failure modes to your function that then report a wider variety of errors that can still complicate use, and it especially complicates systems as a whole as you start tying up lots of chaining error conditions as you're trying to test coverage of your system. So although wide is seductively appealing, it's not always the right answer. And certainly in Bloomberg, we tend much more towards we don't hide from narrow contracts. They seem to be a very useful thing, and there's a fair few in the standard library. The issue came up, though, when we started trying to design the library. The no except feature came into the standard library, and we had to figure out where to use it. And the issue here is the standard library is a specification, not an implementation, when you're on the standard committee. And if we put no except on the function, that means that if we try and throw out of it, it's going to terminate the process, which might be something you want to do in response to somebody calling you out of contract. So for C++ 11, we came up with a simple set of guidelines for applying to the specification of the standard that says we use no except only on wide contracts, so there's no preconditions. Therefore, there's never a concern about having to call out of contract and how to flag that to the end user. And in order to try and keep things simple, we'd use the conditional form of no except, where you supply the Boolean value only when it was really critical to the performance. So things like the move operations and swap. Likewise, since C++ 98, your vendors have always had freedom to strengthen those accept and safety guarantees, so they can add no except freely where they want to add it. And the idea is, if there's a real concern that we're losing performance here, the expectation is we're going to see library vendors coming through adding no except where they really need it for performance, and we'll then get that feedback and have guidance as to how to move these rules forward in the future. But if you're wondering why you don't see no except widely throughout the standard library specification, this is the general guidance we were using. So, quick example to ask a question of, is a contract narrow or wide? Here's a simple function. AutoSum takes int A, int B, int C, and returns an int, and returns the mathematical sum of A, B, and C. Is this a narrow or a wide contract? I'm seeing a hand going up.
You have to worry about integer overflow when you do the sum, so...
So, I'm going to ask the question, do you believe this? I want to see a show of hands. Who thinks this is a narrow contract? Probably about somebody other than half the room. Who thinks this is a wide contract? Probably about 25%. And who really doesn't know or hasn't formed an opinion yet? Okay, we've still got a reasonably opinionated room. About 25% don't know yet. So, going the wrong way here. It's exactly the issue that you mentioned. There's an implicit precondition here that the sum will be representable. Otherwise, we're going to have undefined behavior forced on us by the language. So my preference at this point is you should therefore always document your precondition rather than let the user infer it from these. Yeah, Nico.
You can question whether an overflow is undefined behavior.
Nico says we can question whether an overflow is undefined behavior. Not really. We know we're writing this with C++, or my assumption with this audience is that all the slides you will see are talking about C++. And the C++ standard clearly spells out that overflow on an int is undefined behavior. It might be well documented to do something different on the specific implementation, but this is a general piece of C++ code. So the question is, if the contract is narrow, how can the user protect themselves to know that they're calling this in contract? And yep, that's a problem. Not all narrow contracts are easily checkable. And sometimes the cost of checking them at the user end is more than it's worth. But they also need to understand that if we can't represent the answer, they're not going to get back a good answer. So is this, do we believe, the correct contract now for the function? Well, specifically, let's move on. This becomes my implementation. Does my implementation satisfy the contract? So I'm going to look for that. Who believes I am now satisfying the contract with a simple implementation? Who thinks, other than the fact I might be asking a trick question, that this is clearly maybe not satisfying the contract? Okay, we're getting about half the room going up. Yeah, the issue is if I call with int max 2 and minus 3, the sum is representable, but the operation itself is going to overflow. So the question at this point is, do I have a bug in my implementation, or do I have a bug in my contract? So let's demonstrate. We can fix this. First of all, I'm going to check that if A and B have different signs, I can therefore safely add those and know that that will not overflow, and therefore can just check whether or not I can safely return by checking the appropriate int max in min back rows. I can check whether or not I can safely return a representable value. I can then otherwise go on if A and C are opposite signs or B and C are opposite signs. And finally, okay, they've all got the same sign, I've got to do something a little bit more complicated. And finally, if you fall off the end, we're in contract violation mode. So we can actually honor the contract as given. Do we think this looks reasonable? And do we think this looks bug-free?
Yeah.
Because naturally it's a quick question. I sat down to write it out and then figured that, yeah, because I assume when I got to this point that all things have the same sign, but I missed that if zero doesn't have a sign, so I could still fall through. So there's an extra check I need to put if A equals zero. So, yeah, we can get this right. And I think that's actually a very useful contract to get right, because people can easily check for getting adding two values correctly, but adding three without overflow is actually a more involved process, and if that's what you really need, that's a useful contract. Of course, an easier fix could just be fix the contract. Beeman.
It just seems to me that you can never answer the narrow or wide just by looking at the signature. You must have the
So Beeman's observation is that from just reading the signature, you can't easily tell, or really don't have the information to tell, whether a contract is narrow and wide. You need the documented contract to see that. And yes, that was essentially the point I was starting with. Documentation is key. And when I think about documentation, I'm very specifically thinking about contracts, because that's what your interaction with your library user is essentially the contracts you write as much as the code. As I say, most of the rest of the presentation is things I learned about considering contracts when I was then looking at the standard library. So here was my question from earlier, is narrow or wide better? As I said, narrower contracts are generally easier to implement, and wider contracts are generally easier to use, as long as you don't get too detailed worrying about your error conditions. So I'm not going to give you some general advice that one is better than the other. You know the library you're writing, you know the context it's likely to be used in, so exercise your engineering judgment. But think about some of these concerns when you're trying to nail down, do you have the right contract for your interface? And quick correction for trying to get the original implementation correctly, we can do it a relatively simple way. We'll just promote to long internally and do the operation at a higher precision. And being the standards geek I am, I'm also going to make sure, at least with a static assert, that my long is not the same size as my int, because you can find all sorts of interesting implementations out there. I think my favorite friend told me he was working with DSPs, and on his system, char, short, int, long, and long were all 24 bits. Distinct types, identical representation. Beeman. So Beeman's observation is that when he writes code like this, he will not be using type int, he will be using the standard type defs int 32. So users actually have a good idea about the representation they have underneath, which helps them in their reasoning about the program and is essentially additional contractual information put up there in the signature. And again, it depends, are you trying to write some code? The notion of int is supposed to match the system registers, whether or not that still holds, but you might be writing this deliberately to move with system size. So again, all sorts of interesting questions to think about as you design the API and hopefully before your customers start giving you feedback. Nico.
Strictly speaking, this assertion is not enough. We should say something like long is at least three times of the size of int.
Nico has...
Does it? Well, that's three times or something like that. So if long is just one bit more than int,
size of doesn't traffic in bits, it traffics in whatever the chart, sorry. The point is that because I'm adding three ints, I could be being longer by one bit is not sufficient, but the actual language features available don't have you the ability to increment in bits, it's char bit.
Long could be 5 bytes and int 4 bytes.
But bytes are enough. It's bits that's a problem. I need 2 bits more, but unless I live on a system where char is 1 bit, there's no ability for size of which is in terms of units of char to ever be small enough that if this doesn't pass. And there's also a requirement now from we inherit from C that char bit or the size of char is at least 8 bits. So And by the same token, int will be at least 16 bits and long long at least 64. So you're in a very perverse system if this doesn't hold. I like to dot all my I's and cross my T's. So another notion that I again learned from John early in my time at Bloomberg was we had an interesting design problem where we're designing a class for use in representing part of our spreadsheet. So it's essentially an integer range that says I've got a range of cells are the focus of this operation. And you know, the idea is it's a contiguous sequence of numbers, so it'll be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or it will represent 18, 19, 20. So it clearly starts somewhere and ends somewhere or has a length. So how do we represent this interface? And there's two common ways you would think about approaching this. We could have store the first and last, or we could store first and length. And does the choice of implementation here have any bearing on the interface? Clearly the answer is yes, or I wouldn't be asking the question. So design questions we had approaching what we were trying to use with integer range. Do we need to support sequences that go both forwards and backwards? Do we need to constrain last to be representable as an int? What are the most important operations that we're using on the range? So in our case, we were always just representing ranges going forward. We didn't have to worry about positive, negative there. Do we need to represent last as an int? It's useful, but we knew that within the ranges we were dealing with, we were never going to be getting up to the 4 billions or 2 billions where you know, the representability of the end was going to be a concern for us. So last was, whether or not it was representable was unlikely to be a huge concern. Test for membership was clearly a key thing for us. Translating, moving a range backwards and forwards, up and down, or again, combining two ranges. So, looking at design A, we have first is int and length, although John will hate me for this, is unsigned because that allows us to have the length at the start of you know, minus min int, and we can represent the whole range of representable integers this way. You now have a precondition on calling the last function that you have to now know that the last number is representable. So if my start is max int and I've got max unsigned t, there's absolutely no way I'm going to be able to represent the value of last. That's now got a precondition. But the big benefit is first and last can now both be set independently of each other. There's no connection between those two. We'll see on the other representation that this is not always as true. And the translate, grow, expand, and shrink methods are all direct manipulations of either first or length. So they're very easy, again, wide contracts. And again, the combined join, you know, the union, simply has the precondition that the final length is something you can represent. Design B, we go with first and last, and we have the complex constraint, because remember, all our ranges go forward, that first is less than last. So that now means any operation that has to deal with first and last has to deal with both at the same time. So we call this a complex constraint on the type as a whole. The invariant of the class must hold. So first, last, and length all in turn now have wide contracts, so simply querying those attributes was a little bit more convenient. But every time I'm doing a manipulation operation, I have to set first and last as a pair. And that does complicate usage somewhat. And likewise, we got a wide contract out of the combine and join. Issue here is if I set first and last independently, if I set last before first, I might have gone through a negative range the other way. And if I go first before last, I always have something to check to avoid transiting through an invalid state. So you avoid that by just having manipulations that only operate on both attributes at the same time. So these were our design choices. And we have, you know, is design A or design B better? And yeah, it was design A is often simple to work with because it generally had more simple constraints on the operations we were dealing with. But we got a lot of kickback on this based on model B was actually much closer, despite the complex constraints, to the way people thought about using the type. Now, in the end, we actually went with option A because it did lead to simpler code, but it made people think a bit harder when they were dealing with the system. We still get the occasional kickback on it. Question from Nico at the back. Why is B easier to iterate? B is easier to iterate because it has no invalid values. Everything in B is always of a size int. It never overflows beyond the range. Whereas one of the interesting things with A is I can represent ranges that go beyond max int. It's just very hard to describe and deal with those values. I can manipulate the ranges, I just can't access all the elements in the range unless we have an interface that promotes up to long or something, and we're back to where we were before. Now, for our specific use case, we knew we were never getting close to the boundary conditions, so A actually worked, proved relatively easy to live with, but it means we might have be a little bit lax about checking some of our preconditions sometimes. So, but again, the issue here is to think about if I can design a type where there are no constraints between my types versus introducing constraints between the attributes, it's introducing complexity into how you use the class. This is all, again, part of the contract between you and the user that directly reveals itself in the interface. So that's about as much as I'm going to say on that. Any other questions before I move on? Eric.
I'd say something that's called a range should have begin and end member functions that return iterators.
Eric's point is that if something's called range, it should have begin and end member functions, and they should return iterators. It's not an unreasonable position to hold.
Going into the standard library, would you have any different considerations on it?
If this was going into the standard library, would I have any different considerations on it? I'd have to think about that. These were the considerations we looked at were very specific to the way we were using it. This is certainly a reasonable type to represent in the standard library. And again, the simpler constraints versus complex constraints question would come up in the library design. If I don't know who the actual users for this type are, that's a much harder question to call an answer for. So I'd be very grateful to have a library working group around me to give various opinions. I'm sure I would get various opinions. Beeman and then Gore.
Standard library, that's one of the things that's a real shock when you first come into it, is that one of the most important considerations that comes up with everything for everyone that goes into the standard library is how easy is it for a naive user to make mistakes? And you know, there's a lot of discussion go back and forth because a given parameter, the user may be able to assume they're not.
So, comment for the camera then is that where this is designed in Bloomberg, we know a significant amount about the expertise of our users and what is a reasonable trade-off about risk versus safety. And when you're designing something for the standard library, those trade-offs tend to be fairly different because you're targeting a much wider user base with a much broader range of skills. And these are the kind of concerns that we would discuss in committee. I'm not going to try and give you the answer for this specific design yet because I've not thought about it in those terms. This was just an interesting topic that I saw from within our code that I thought showed an interesting design point to be thinking about when, again, in terms of your contracts, which is the easiest contract to use. Go.
I have a question on the meaning of wide contract. Is that simply means that there is a defined behavior for every input versus it has no failure modes? An example would be size on the vector would always give you a reasonable value no matter what, but at will either give you a value or throw an exception. So,
For the camera, the question is, with wide contracts, is the implication that they always succeed, that there's always defined behavior for every input, or does the existence of failure modes like calling vector at, which throws an exception, indicate that's really a narrow contract? And the understanding is that at has a wide contract, it just documents how it returns its errors for you. So you should always be able to understand from the contract that I will either succeed and get the result that I'm given, or I can expect a failure reported in this kind of a manner. And if I can't predict the outcome sufficiently to be either I get an error and I know how to catch the error, or I get success and the contract is not properly documented yet.
Okay, why contract define behavior?
Yeah. Okay. So, moving on. Going back into the world of C++ standard libraries and so forth, what is a moved from state is a question I've heard debated significantly over the last 4 or 5 years. So here's our simple example. Auto X is hello world as a string, and then we're going to have string Y, and we're going to move from X. What is the state of X after Y is initialized? We have four choices. I'm going to call for hands again. Who thinks A will, X will be empty after this? I see 3, 4 hands. Who thinks X will have the string hello world after this operation? I see no hands. Who doesn't know what X will hold after this operation? I'm seeing probably about 70% of the room. And who thinks it's undefined behavior to even ask the question? I'm probably seeing about 20% of the room. Who's actually answering this question? I just want to be sure, is what do you think the state should be regardless of what the standard library says? You were arguing from simple. Who is answering the wrong question? Can I have a show of hands? Okay, you all thought you had the right question. That's good to know. Okay, so I'm not going to retake the poll then. This is your answer. The answer is you don't know. The object is in a valid state, but it's not specified. Empty and hello world are both reasonable expectations that the library might implement. If my string is held dynamically, it's going to transfer it across its transferred ownership, so I'm probably going to be left with an empty string. If I'm using the short string optimization, there's a good chance that hello world will fit within that short string, so I will still be left with the string hello world now in both strings. So I don't actually know the final state of X after this operation, but I have sufficient information to query it if I really care. It means I can use it safely in any other function that has that documents its preconditions. So it's definitely not undefined behavior to ask. And I keep hearing that this is supposed to be correct, and I understand people have this as an ideological position, but it's not correct when applied to the standard library. Alan? Sorry, I thought I heard a, was it?
Yeah.
Yeah, sorry. Well, actually, if you look, because I'm using a string literal, use define literal with string suffix, it's actually C++ 14. But yes, short string optimizations went into C++ 11. Yes.
At the beginning, you described the documentation should not mention the implementation. And now you actually answer the question by referring to the implementation. Is that even written in the standard library documentation?
This is me just giving an example of using the standard library and asking you what you expect. And the answer is, from the standard library documentation, I know I do not know the answer. Because the actual final result of X depends upon a specific library implementation. And this is something where library vendors have freedom to do different things. The important point is I am left in a valid state. It's not undefined behavior to even ask the question. Beeman.
Dave Abrahams often made the point that it's extremely, it's an extremely unfortunate design choice to break an object's invariant and that's where this whole thing about valid but unspecified comes from.
Can you put the next slide up? But yeah, the observation is that, you know, Dave Abrahams has mentioned that it would be an unfortunate design choice, because your move from state of your object is whatever you yourself as a library vendor choose to document. But if you document that as being a state that's invalid, that violates your invariance, it makes your object much harder to use in general, because you've now got, I don't know when I can use one of these things if they're passed by reference through an arbitrary API, for example. Or I now have to start feeding up preconditions on all my interfaces that don't pass me one of these things in its special moved from state. So. So point from Sean is that there's just an implicit precondition that all my objects I pass to functions are fully formed and correct, and I'm not disputing that. The point is that you don't put your object into a state where it no longer satisfies those conditions having established it's in a valid state without simply destroying it.
It's unavoidable. You won't win this argument.
And Sean and I have distinctly different views on this, and please repeat the question. Sean's point was that if I'm calling a function or I'm taking an object by value, by reference, whatever, it's the caller's responsibility to make sure that object is valid. And that's an implicit precondition that comes out of the language. There's nothing to say in our contracts about that. And this is quite true. We never say, you pass me by reference, you pass me a reference to an object that actually exists. That's implicit in the language. Sean's point is that once I have moved from an object, he would like to think of it as being in that completely invalid broken state where there's a tiny set of things you can do with it. I believe he'd like to just destroy or reassign to it. And I'm not going to, as we said, we're not going to hold that design discussion here. That's not the design decision the library has chosen. It's not an unreasonable choice as long as you document your classes that way, but I believe you've made life for your users harder. You'll have a hard time using those types in the standard library, but expect you to be using this as part of the constraints they describe across their requirements clauses. This is a broad requirement, expectation of standard library algorithms, for instance. So what does a valid but unspecified state mean? It's safe to call functions that have no preconditions, functions with wide contracts, and if you're particularly determined using just that interface, you can learn enough about the current state to safely call functions with narrow contracts if you care about that. And to give a specific example, it means code like this stays valid. You know, if V is empty, then I can call, if V is not empty, I can call V front. And I don't need to worry if what came in was a move from state, because we know that I have a valid object and it's either empty or not, and if it's not empty, I can access the front. And this kind of thing in a generic piece of template code will not have to worry about whether you pass me a move from object. Alan. So Alan's point is he's having a hard time understanding when I might want to do something with a move from object other than assign to it or destroy it. And, you know, pass a move from object into a template that does this. The point is, as soon as I have to start allowing for that, that complicates contracts all over my code. Because I have to start worrying about this. I've added an additional state to the state space of my object that is a valid state for that object is, I'm now in a state where all I can do is assign to it or move from it. I don't even have a query function to say, are you in that state? It's my responsibility as a user to know and track that all throughout my code. And there's nothing magical or special about operations that take R value references. So why do I want to break my object just because somebody called it through an R value? I want to push that discussion aside for another day now, because I've still got a whole lot more material to get through. This was illustrative of the kind of questions and design discussions that you think about when you start thinking seriously about the contracts you're describing for your users. You've heard two kinds of contracts you might choose to describe here. I'm not going to say which one's better apart from I'm right. No. Moving on, separate topic. Templates are a frequent source of bad contracts. It's not that templates in themselves are innately a bad thing, but people still have a hard time either correctly documenting their templates or providing an appropriate level of usability or testability, as we're about to see, of their contracts. So if you're trying to document templates, not only do you have to document the runtime behavior of the parameters that are coming through, you have to document exactly what's required of each type or template parameter. They can also be non-type template parameters. When you're implementing your template, you should never rely on anything in the implementation on anything you've not explicitly documented as a requirement on those types. Unquestioned assumptions abound is my observation of most template libraries I've seen. What we do in the standard library, as a useful technique, is we collect common requirements together and give them a name. I'm calling them concepts here. I'll have to use a different name when concepts actually enters the language, although it's essentially the same idea. But we can do the same thing just in straight documentation, and those are the requirements tables in the C++ standard at the moment.
Is there anything you can say about unquestioned assumptions? They come in a category? Or
can you come back to me after I go through the next dozen slides or so? So one of my questions here is, what makes a bad contract? I'm thinking specifically about templates at this point. And my concern here that drove me nuts when I was first trying to test my homebrew standard library is, when I've got very permissive contracts, because we didn't state too much, if we don't state a lot, then our contract is actually just very permissive. So, and then you end up with many awkward types as people start taking confrontational approaches to, well, your template didn't say you couldn't do this, I expect you to support this. So we either have a very high burden on implementers and testers to make sure that you are strictly in conformance with that standard, or we can better document what we expect you to use and not overly constrain our implementations. So a very general, under-documented contract, as I would say, becomes difficult to implement, difficult to test, tricky for users to extend, either to specialize or to meet the similar kind of constraints, because they've now got to be as general as all that cost you've given to yourself. And support can impact performance. If you don't say that the type can't overload the operator ampersand, you have to have any attempt where you need to get the address of the object now go through standard address of, which is some funny funky casts unless there's an intrinsic in your compiler. So simple things suddenly become a lot more complicated, and those can actually have runtime costs. But if you get too restrictive, the contract does become tricky to read and use, because you're now documenting so much and the user's got to figure out what their type is. So there is a trade-off. I'm concerned that things have gone too much in this direction at the moment, which is why I'm about to give an example.
Is an actual problem you've observed, or is it just an arbitrary example? Have you ever observed that generation?
What is a predicate for the standard library? So imagine I'm trying to implement standard set. What range of types do I put into the... what set of types do I need to test to be sure I have completely tested coverage of my standard set type with that predicate for the comparator? Clearly, it's, a function that takes two parameters of type T, returns a bool. Or a type convertible to bool. So there's a whole variety of things that my function can now be returning that I have to be prepared to deal with. Of course, it can be a function pointer or a function reference. The parameters might pass by const reference or by non-const reference, as long as the user guarantees not to call non-const operations through them. That's explicitly allowed. Or they could pass their parameters by value. It might be two different types that are convertible to T, so I've got to check I'm not getting any strange ambiguities in or problems from these conversions. Convertible const reference to T, or I could be deducing my parameters through forwarding references. Of course, it could actually be a functor class, overloading operator bool TT, or just... I might drop the const qualification because that's not required. Could be a function template of T and U. Could even take more than two parameters as long as all the others are defaulted. It may be a class convertible to a function pointer using a conversion operator, or to a function reference. It could be the result of a generic lambda expression. I'm not sure if that's already covered by that set or not, so at this point might as well throw it into the test matrix, because we've already got that much to test. And remember that those types might be unions or final classes in case I'm doing any clever derivation from my type. So, and it might not even be default constructible, because that's not required. And I can be overloading operator address of and so forth. That type that's convertible to bool can do any of these tricks. It can have an explicit conversion operator. It might be move only. It might not be default constructible in turn. So I can't, make a, if I ever want to make one of these things as part of my generic implementation, to default it and then compare, no, that's not allowed. It can be overloading operator double ampersand, breaking short circuit evaluation. So I'd best not be using simple test and something, because on the assumption that would short circuit, because that might not hold. Same with operator or. Might overload operator ampersand, might overload operator comma. That's more of a problem with iterators, to be fair. And it can overload operator not and operator equal, not equal. And I've got to test the whole power set of the combination of these to make sure that my implementation doesn't rely on anything if one of these violates my assumptions. This makes implementing and testing standard containers fiendishly difficult if you're concerned about conforming to the standard. So yes, overly general contracts hurt. It means that 95% plus of my test code and my implementation is testing things that will never occur, because that's what the standard library has required. My only point here is, please think and document your templates more carefully. And if you think that going to the broadest range of acceptance is a good thing, please think of this as a counterexample. Eric.
I'd like to point out, this is why concepts help in the specification. And this is why when we add concepts to the standard library, code that takes advantage of this wiggle room is likely to break.
So Eric's observation is, concepts going into the standard library will help an awful lot with this kind of overflow, because these concepts will be baked in, we'll have a better understanding of what they are, and also when we start nailing down these concepts, we might start ruling out some of these things so corner cases break. That's absolutely what we chose not to do when trying to implement C++ OX, became C++ 11, and we're reconsidering that position as we're moving forward with the ranges TS as our initial inspiration. Thank you, Eric. Nico. I do not believe that is a requirement. I am perfectly capable of logging calls and having a count of how many times an operator was called, but the state should not affect the evaluation of the predicate. You're correct in that sense. I missed that particular precondition. But that this all just showed up in the interface. That is a semantic requirement over and above. That doesn't. Thank you for going out. The question is that Nico believes that what I have not called out is that a predicate function should be stateless. And I disputed that. The issue is the state should not actually impact on the evaluation of the predicate. And even that's not true, as long as the state that impacts the predicate doesn't change. It should give repeatable results for the same inputs throughout the lifetime of the predicate, yes.
By the way, it would be a more complicated concept to formulate.
And Nico says that's a more complicated concept to formulate. Concepts are very good at the syntactic requirements. The semantic requirements are still much more left to documentation and convention. But, Gore, last question then and moving on.
Alex Stepanov gives an advice for generic, algorithm. You mm-hmm. go for the least restrictive set of constraints, and to a degree, you're putting a balance, saying if you go with Alex Stepanov's advice, it will hurt.
So the observation is Alex Stepanov says when you're writing generic code, you should cleave to the least minimal set of constraints to be maximally useful to your users. And yes, I am suggesting a balance that if you go too far in that direction, I'm not sure if it's a consequence of C++ that causes all of these problems or whether it's true of generic systems and it across languages. But certainly in the world I'm dealing with, overly generic is actually imposing a huge cost that very few users really care about.
Yeah, I would actually argue with Alex's position on that. He's very much in favor of strong semantics and generality comes with having strong semantics.
So again, Sean's observation is a lot of my issues here come from the semantics as opposed to the syntax of the because all we can check is the syntax in C++ and we don't have a semantic bundled up with a concept. That's why we end up with this mess that Alex's minimal set of requirements includes a semantic, and that solves a lot of these problems. So I'm going to move on, because I have more to talk about still. Some examples now specifically applying to things I learned going through the standard library. So again, thinking in terms of subtle implicit contracts, that I thought there was an implicit contract here in the standard library, it turned out to be quite explicit. But if you think about designing an exception class, they're designed for use reporting exceptional conditions, and any class can be used, but some are going to work better than others. So in the standard, by convention, all standard libraries derive from standard exception, which provides this virtual signature. Anyone know of the example that doesn't derive from standard exception? No bad out derived from standard exception. No, nested exception. The whole point of nested exception is that you can catch it separately and then throw the standard exception from within. But I didn't put it on the slide because it's a corner case that most people don't care about. Often designed as a type hierarchy, this is just general nature of designing exceptions to report information through the type as well as through the content of the exception, so you can catch them at the appropriate fine grain. We've got runtime error, logic error, system error are the three classic base classes you might be using to derive from. Key issue is that when you copy an exception, it shouldn't throw. So when we throw an exception, we make a copy into some special location in the system. Then when we catch by value, the system makes another copy. So what happens if that copy operation throws? Program's going to terminate. It's the required behavior. So if you want to have a class that's usable as an exception, be aware that not just catch by value, the system has the ability to copy your exception freely at will inside the exception machinery. And if it does so and throws, your program's going to terminate. So classes with throwing copy constructors are poor choices for exception classes. Which brings us to, I was probably going to jump two slides here. Standard exception classes, we've got bad alloc, bad cast, and so forth. These are great, these just hold a pointer to a string literal. But runtime error and logic error, we pass a string to them, so they've got to dynamically allocate a string. But we want these things to, with string, it's no longer allowed to be copy on write in C++11, so it's got a throwing copy constructor, which is really not good for what you're storing in your standard library exceptions. So the end result that, this is one of the ones I learned from Howard Hinnant, credit where it's due, your standard library actually has two reference counted immutable string types in the standard library. When you throw one of these types, the constructor takes a string and will dynamically allocate a reference counted string object used just by that exception, because you can increment the reference counts without throwing. So, little known corner of the standard, your standard exception classes, they all have no throw copy constructors, and that means that you actually have two immutable reference counted string types, but there's not a lot you can do with them because we just revealed the const char star string internally. But again, thinking about your contract, your design of the language, ends up in these interesting positions. Slide I jumped over is what happens if the initial call to throw in turn throws, making the initial object before I make the copy. And that's still well-defined behavior. I just get the copy from the constructor that I tried to call propagating because I don't have an exception object yet. So everything's still well-defined. Random slide, broken symmetry. This is just a few corners where the standard kind of got it wrong or has made life a little bit more complicated than we might want to think about it. Vector bool doesn't satisfy the constraints of being a standard container because the iterator's returning proxies and having a compressed representation if we go that way violate a bunch of the requirements that we expect of standard containers. Basic string, in C++03 we allowed for the copy-on-write implementation. That meant there's a whole bunch of things that you expected to work for all containers didn't hold, so calling just begin on a string would invalidate all iterators to that string. This was kind of surprising. C++11, we've fixed all those shortcomings to enable short string optimizations instead, which violate a different set of constraints so that swap can invalidate iterators where it wouldn't normally. Because we're allowing for the implementation to be potentially stored within the string object itself or potentially shared. Not shared, potentially dynamically allocated. A concern I have that we'll be getting experience back with the library fundamentals TS is we now have a shared pointer specialization for array types. This means we have shared pointers that do not overload operator arrow and operator star because they're expected to be using the operator square bracket that isn't normally available on shared pointers to access elements instead. So we now have two different interfaces to the same template. I think this is a great class if it was called shared array. Some people believe the convenience of the name outweighs the inconvenience of now having two different kinds of shared pointer in the system. The great thing about a TS is we'll get some feedback to find out who's correct. Or hopefully more correct. Standard array has no allocator support, which means that if I've got a vector of strings I would generally like to have my strings have this. If I'm using a stateful allocator, I would like the strings to have the same allocator as the vector. If I've got a vector of standard array of strings, there's no way to propagate the allocator from the vector to the strings in the array. Just an awkward corner that comes from the way we had to specify standard array. Array T0 is kind of sounds like this, where we've put a specialization in, so is it a different interface? Turns out that we've got a special implementation, but it preserves the single interface. Why does array T0 have front and back functions that have very narrow contracts? You're never allowed to call them. But it still has them. So yeah, Jared's basically calling out what will be my next example, a function a bit like this, where as long as I'm checking a generic condition, I'm being passed any container, and I don't want to rule out array of length 0. And if I check empty, I'm going to return the address of the first element. So if it's not empty, I get the address of front using standard addressive because I paid attention to myself earlier. Otherwise, I return a null pointer. And this will still compile and work correctly if I pass an array of 0 length. So that's why, even though I can't call this, I arranged just never to call it, and my generic code continues to work correctly. So even functions that can never be called might be important to have in your interface. They've just got a particularly narrow contract. So I'm running low on time compared to, I think, where I want to get, so I'm going to jump through a bunch of these slides quickly. One of my idioms is just follow the design language of the library in front of you. So we've got one notion is container, iterators, and algorithms, and Eric's about to extend this significantly with ranges as well. And the other notion is we've got a design language or a familiar set of naming idioms around traits. So tap traits, our naming consistent tends to be is something for testing a property, add or remove underscore, so people have an expectation of what to find in their traits. The result of a trait to produce a type is always a nested :: type member. If it's going to be an is trait or a producer quantity, we always derive from standard integral constant, which is a bit of an odd idiom unless you're thinking in terms of perhaps doing tag dispatch, which I'll talk about in a few slides' time. That means any trait can simply drop into a simple tag dispatch mechanism, which is why we rely on that. Sorry, I'm running a bit faster because I know I've got a bunch of slides I want to get to that would be unfortunate to time out in the middle of. But tap traits, again, they've evolved in the language. C++ 14 allows the _T form for a type alias to the template, which sounds like a minor thing, but it means you end up not needing to use the type name along with a :: type. So it actually just reads a lot simpler in practice once you start using these things in templates. We also, in the library fundamentals TS, use the C++ 14 variable templates feature to do a similar thing for accessing the computed types of variables. My experience with this is implementing my own homebrew STL. I actually prefer to implement these first and have the old traits take their value from the variable template, because the variable template code is actually much simpler, because I'm not going from a value to a type to do computations with the type to get back to a value. I just go from value to value. So the language is evolving, or the design language. Containers have a bunch of common operations that, in a very small font, you can take a look at these in the slides after the presentation. But the general idea that you have begin and end to get it, access the range iterators with a C prefix or an R prefix for constant and reverse, swap shouldn't be invalidating things, a bunch of common expected behaviors. Container members have a common set of type defs, will optimize swap. You can expect an empty method to query whether or not a container is empty or not. Again, just part of the common design language that if you're designing your own containers, it's a good idea to follow along. It's then familiar and more broadly usable to a wider user community. And comes along, this is to an extent the implicit contract you get from following the standard library conventions. Iterators form a conceptual hierarchy. So we have the input iterator, the forward iterator, the bidirectional, the random access, And as of C++ 17, we start talking about contiguous iterators, which basically gives you a guarantee that the underlying elements in the sequence are actually in contiguous memory, so you can maybe take the address and manipulate them as raw pointers. Key difference between input iterator and forward iterator: most people are aware that you get the stable iteration guarantee. A lot of people miss the fact that when you have a forward iterator, it's now required to return a true reference rather than any kind of proxy to the underlying type. This is part of the reason why vector bool is broken, because vector bool iterators are essentially input iterators and not random access iterators, although most standard libraries will lie and give you the random access iterator tag. Question?
What would be an algorithm that requires a contiguous iterator rather than a random access iterator?
So the question is, what would be an algorithm that requires a contiguous iterator rather than a random access iterator? I don't have any ready examples. This is a guarantee that comes out if we have containers that guarantee contiguous storage in the standard library, and there was a desire to express that in the iterator documentation in a way that users might make use of it. The standard library itself does not. We're giving you a stronger guarantee than is required by any other standard library uses, but because we know all implementations do this, and it's a guarantee that users have been known to rely on turning iterators into pointers and back again, that we want to, it's been deemed worth giving them that guarantee since they like to rely on it anyway. Yeah. So as Jahao has just pointed out, something that isn't clear from my slide, contiguous iterators, I'm assuming people have read C++ 17. The issue here is this is not actually an iterator tag like random access iterator, it's just a documented additional guarantee. So nothing that you can query in code will tell you that you have a contiguous iterator, at least in the current state of the working paper. So again, working through iterator traits, the idea is if you're manipulating iterators or working with iterators, you should generally deal with their properties through the traits, because they have a common interface. Anyone want to tell me why double equals is here in red? Common properties of all iterators, they've got plus plus, equal equal, star, and arrow. Only I'm claiming equal equal is actually not correctly in that set. I'm not going to let Eric answer. Okay, you'll get it on the next slide. The other thing we supply is five standard type defs for dealing with things that you'll want to manipulate through the iterator. Aperture iterators are the oddball, because output iterators do not require operator equal equal. So I've got a pure output iterator, it's not also an input iterator. It's not going to have, it might not have operator equal equal, because we just keep writing, we never query have I got to the end of that output range. It's not a property of the concept. But it still has the common plus plus interface and the star. I think, does it have arrow, Eric?
No, I don't think so. It's just for readable.
Okay. So that way, forward iterators are guaranteed to be both input and output iterators, yet the library is full of const iterators that are not output iterators. And we fudge this with describing mutable and constant iterators. So a constant iterator is one that meets the other hierarchies, but its reference type is a const ref, so you can't write through it. You learn as you go. So working with iterators, the whole point is you should be going through the iterator traits. Seeing where I'm in terms of slides. I'm 71 slides in out of 173. I'm not going to get to the end. The rest go faster. Iterator traits supports pointer. The whole reason to go through iterator traits is so that you can treat pointers as iterators or similar types. If you start trying to access those funny type defs from within the iterator, they don't exist for pointers. So always query your iterator's properties through the traits rather than thinking you go to the iterator directly. On the other hand, if you're implementing an iterator, it's much simpler to supply the type defs inside the iterator than to separately specialize the traits. The traits will correctly deduce as long as you put the types there. And it's a slightly simpler implementation. I'd say you could have a lesser dependency because I no longer need to introduce iterator traits to specialize it because that's going to do all the hard work. But the iterator tag that you're going to supply is in exactly the same header, so your actual dependency envelope isn't going to go down. C++ 17 goes slightly further with the type traits type def. When it builds the iterator traits type, if your type is not an iterator or doesn't support the appropriate type def, it will now no longer show up as a type, but the iterator trait will instantiate. So I can now do Sphinx metaprogramming to detect whether or not a type is an iterator. That comes in C++ 17. Tag dispatch I spoke about earlier, I'm sorry, I'm going to jump through this because I want to get on to some other concepts. Recurring theme that I went through that inspires a lot of what's about to follow is when I'm testing templates or testing code in general, there's two notions. There's black box testing, which is where I'm explicitly testing against the contract. And there's also white box testing, where because I have access to the implementation, I know where the implementation might diverge into to do different things. So in addition to testing the boundary conditions of the black box documented by the user, I might have additional internal constraints that I need to test as well. So just be aware when you're testing, you want to be a bit white box as well as black box. The test driver itself is ideally black box, but the concerns that you're testing are white box. And as a consequence, you generally tend to write a lot more test code than actual library implementation, was another thing that I learned. Key of testing templates, you're testing against those type guarantees, so make sure you've got a wide battery of types that challenge your assumptions in all those horrible ways. Have your type that overloads the addressive operator, the comma operator, does the crazy things with comparisons and so forth, is not default constructible, maybe is not copy constructible, or has an explicit copy constructor. All sorts of wonderful crazy ways you can make seemingly broken types that, if you've not said you don't support, they're in your set of guarantees that you have to test. When I'm testing my algorithms, I will generally use iterator adapters that are designed to be the minimal conforming iterator that do these horrible things. Equality comparison on these iterators returns the most evil Boolean type I can imagine. Those Boolean types generally delete all the operations you expect to do on Booleans, which at least solves the short-circuiting problem. Might even have iterators that produce only empty ranges, so certain operations are again not going to be very helpful. But yes, test the types that overload operator, addressive, comma, and so forth. So this is my go-to list when I start thinking about stress testing a template. I'll have a type that's not default constructible, type that's move only, type that's immutable. These don't apply to all templates, but just consider your contract and see if it's supposed to support these. Make sure you've got one of these to test with. Make my copy, move, and default constructors explicit. Overload those awkward operators. Have a type that either has an implicit constructor taking a single argument so it converts from anything, or an operator template that can convert to anything, or even have one that does both. Play around with unions or final classes in C++ 11, just in case I'm relying on inheritance as an implementation detail, even if that's just in the template metaprogram to test a property. Use reference qualifiers on key methods, because that will screw me up quite badly, so I discovered, unfortunately. This is from C++ 11 onward, obviously. And be awkward in multiple of those dimensions at the same time, just in case testing on one of the dimensions sets me down one code path, so I don't test it with the combination. So test individually and have one really awkward type which has as much of those as possible. What I was trying to get to is, yeah, this is going to take more than 20 minutes. A bunch of things I learned implementing tuple, because there were a fair few interesting design decisions along the way. And again, this is probably more on the implementation side of the standard library, but in thinking about how do I implement to provide the widest usable type as easy as possible. My initial notion of implementing tuple was, I've got a tuple of types, and the easiest, because you can't have a packet expansion of member variables of types, ideally I want to derive from them and say, I'll just derive from one of these defined types, and then I can easily cast to the appropriate base to pull out the element. Clearly it's not going to work, but this is where I'm going to start and say, what do I have to do to make something like this work? So, obvious problems, if I've got an int, or an enum, or a pointer, or a reference, or even a union, that approach isn't going to work. So what I do is I simply wrap the types in a type wrapper that I can now pull the element out of. And that does let me do this flat pack expansion of base classes rather than doing a recursive deep template instantiation. So this is a nice first step. Anyone see the problem with this? Duplicate types. I've got a tuple of int and int, and now I have duplicate base classes. So that's not quite going to work. So now we have to have an index. Where do we get that index from? This was a problem that took me about 18 months to figure out. I think all the other vendors got it much faster than I did. And we've now actually standardized this trick for C++ 14. Essentially, I'm going to have a tuple impl class, where in addition to taking all the types, I'll have an indexer type. And I'm not going to, that's a primary template, I'm not going to define it. What I actually want is a packet expansion of size T types with a similar of an identical size to a packet expansion of the types I'm using. So if I can generate a type called index sequence that has a packet expansion of that, that's my type. And then I can match up my index to my types in a single packet expansion, because the parameter packs are both of the same length. And that then gives me the ability to derive from the right base class. And then my tuple. In the ideal world, I'd have used an alias template, but we give the library users the ability to specialize tuple for their own user types. I don't think this is possible to actually do in practice because of having to support things like get and all the other operations that happen on tuple without knowing the underlying library implementation. But unfortunately, the alias template approach doesn't work, so not doing that. We're now back to deriving from tuple impl, put all our constructors in the impl, and we can then use C++ 11 inheriting constructors, and that gives us the basis for a tuple implementation. So, this brings us to the next interesting concern with my design. Assume I've got a type like this. I've got namespace my, struct stuff with a data member, and I design provide a stream insertion operator for it. Now in main, I make a tuple of y into my stuff, and then stream out y. What should happen at this point? Anyone who knows the tuple interface? It should indeed be a compiler error. What actually happens here? Argument dependent lookup happens here. And it says, among this set of rules, I've got an associated set of namespaces for a class template that include the namespace of, ultimately, the parameter types that I instantiate the template with, as well as the template itself. Which means, going back here, this is actually going to write out stuff data. It's going to ignore the int, because I'm just calling the stream insertion operator in namespace my that I found, because I don't have a stronger overload for tuple itself. So this will stream, and that might be... This is a simple example to show it's surprising, but it's a property we want to kill from our implementation, because it's not going to behave correctly. So this is our current implementation, where we're deriving from tuple impl. The fix is simple. We just actually make it a data member. And that's the final level of insulation that we need. So we are still associated with that other namespace. That ADL lookup does not go away. What does go away is we don't actually find a matching overload, so we're not going to add it to our overload set, or we're not going to call it. So this is where I went with the idea of details matter. This is the kind of detail you have to get right when you're thinking about implementing what looks like a simple library type tuple. Tuple is anything but simple in practice. Another concern that comes up when you're implementing the standard library is people don't like to pay for what they don't need. So what's the size of standard less or standard allocator? Nobody wants to take the question? Go.
One.
Typically, it's going to be one. Objects are not allowed to be empty. So, it's on the slide. So, all objects require a unique address. They have a size of at least one. If you're wondering why this is, assume I add standard less to be of size zero, and I create an array of standard less objects. I can no longer do arithmetic through my array to know when I've got to the end of the array, because all the elements in the array have the same address. So pointer arithmetic is not going to correctly reflect arithmetic for arrays. So this decision was made a long time ago in C that to preserve the pointer arithmetic expectations, empty objects do not have a zero size. On the other hand, in C++, we do allow that if the object, if your base class subobject is empty, so standard less a standard allocator used as a base class, it can actually share the same address as your object itself and effectively have a zero size. So this is an optimization people like to use to squeeze out, if I've got empty base classes like standard less or standard allocator in my set, I don't want to pay additional storage for types that shouldn't pay for it. And the way we do this, of course, is we derive from it. So here we have the initial idea. This is what we want to essentially move to. So what I'm doing here is if I've got an empty base, I'm going to have methods that rather than returning a base member, just cast star this, and I will then do all my operations using functions to retrieve my allocator and my comparator in this case. And of course we have those famous awkward users who give me all the same problems that I had when I was discussing tuple. So, again, similar idea. So this is not going to work. What we actually do is we simply store all our data members in containers where we expect to use the empty base in a tuple, and then the tuple API gives us a way to get those out again. Again, it's a great piece of advice I got from Howard Hinnant. It's solving my ADL issues. It's want to use this to give me my empty base optimization for free. As long as I was implementing something like this in the first place, I don't even need to query about trying to optimize the container to pull out the empty bases, because that will all happen appropriately in the tuple. I've got a couple of hands going up, but I'm not quite finished on this section. So
is tuple actually guaranteed to collapse empty members?
It is, but my implementation I showed you doesn't do that yet, which is what I was about to get to. The question is tuple guaranteed to do this compression for empty base classes? So the answer is yes. The implementation I showed you doesn't do that yet. So my implementation, having gone through those other concerns, is still not quite complete. So if we go back here, this is how my tuple impl works. I'm deriving from a wrap of index and types, so I'm using the derivation idiom correctly within the tuple impl, but I didn't do the empty base optimization yet. So essentially, I'm going to have a class like this, template size t size type, because that was our interface for type. It's going to have a data member, data, and I'm going to have function called data, overloaded for const and non-const that returns a reference to that data member. Then I want to have a specialization to support when the base class is, I was interested in going empty, I've actually changed this to being the assumption that it's a valid base class. What's a valid base class in general? First of all, it's a class type, so I'm not going to try and derive from references or pointers or enums or ints. It's not a union. I'm not allowed to derive from unions. And it's not a final class, so this trait was added to C++ 14, so you couldn't actually do this correctly for C++ 11 tuple until we added this to C++ 14, unless you got together with your compiler vendor to give you an intrinsic. But that then simply gives me the properties I'm checking, so I can make that a defaulted template parameter, and I'm then going to specialize for the case that bool is true and use the inheritance instead, and then inherit all the base classes, all the base class constructors, sorry. And this will finally give me the approach that I said, where I've got all the compressed bases in my tuple, and that then becomes the appropriate primitive for implementing standard containers and anything else that's got template parameters coming in where you might want to exploit the empty base. Much, much simpler to use tuple than implement the empty base again yourself. Question?
Could you explain why you are not using is empty anymore?
Why I'm not using
is empty for the...
So the question is, why am I not using is empty? And the reason is, unions and final classes can be empty. Now, I could limit this to just empty base classes, but in practice, by using the inheriting constructors, I get all the constructors from the base class, which I then no longer need to forward to the data type. There's a bit more work to do on the regular case, because I've got to appropriately be able to construct this thing. This just lets me solve that problem for a lot of the common cases. This will work fairly easily for the integers, pointers, and probably references. I've still got a bit of work to do to correctly forward allocate constructors to final classes and unions. So I'm just putting off into the weeds the less used case for when I get around to testing it. I'm not sure there's any particular benefit to going either way. Virtual base classes. Well, I'm not using virtual inheritance in my implementation.
But if you inherit from something that it's a class, that is not final.
Okay.
It's a virtual class, then you have to construct it from the most derived set.
Good point. So the question is, how am I handling virtual base classes? And the answer is very badly. Remember what I said? You had all those sets of concerns you had to think about and enumerate and come up with the interesting test types. I need to add more types of virtual base classes to my test harness. Thank you. So, moving on about other lessons I learned while implementing tuple. Here's our current implementation. And that doesn't work well when I have an empty tuple, because I now have two ambiguous constructors, because this parameter pack is not deduced. It's a parameter pack that comes from the primary template. So I don't want to have ambiguous overloads there. It's not going to compile. So in the end, I have to provide my own specialization for an empty tuple. Those wonderful little corners. Another design consideration, thinking about tuple, this is in the standard. I've got these methods, tuple size, that we specialize for array and pair as well. C++17 will probably make this a spin-eye-friendly empty type as opposed to defined only if you specialize it. But question is, what about CV-qualified tuple types? Do I need to go and provide all those extra overloads again and again for pair and again for array and again for any expect users to do the same? The answer is no. If you've got a general pattern that the CV qualified form should behave the same as the unqualified form, simply use derivation to forward the trait. And so we do this in the standard, largely problem solved. Final thing I'm going to get through, and I'm probably not going to get through all these slides. Thinking about testing my tuple, I've got my empty tuple. Here's my test harness. And there's a simple principle I like to live by, which is test the library and not the compiler, or you'll spend forever writing these tests. But I still looked at this as my basic test harness and said, these are all the ways I can kind of default constructor type, and these are the ways I can kind of copy constructor type. So I just want to be sure that I don't fail anything simple. And I'm going to start with my empty tuple, because that's the first part I implemented ahead of all the rest. Any of these things that are clearly going to fail? Bingo. That was actually a function declaration, so that'll not be a test. But given that, at this point, am I testing the library or am I testing the compiler? Who thinks I'm testing the library? Who thinks I'm testing, just a couple of hands, who thinks I'm testing the compiler? Who doesn't know where I'm going with this? Most of the room. Okay, you feel you're being led on. You see my implementation of tuple. Empty tuple. This is the type we're testing into the test framework. How many of these lines are going to fail? How many say none? I don't see a very confident. Okay. I see three or four hands. How many say less than three? How many say less than six? How many say more than six? Who just hasn't got a clue then? You want to see the answer. This is how much simpler could my class be? This is just default construct and copy construct. And yes, these fail. The problem is that's an aggregate type. So when I do aggregate initialization down here, I find out that the class is not a member of itself, therefore I can't aggregate initialize with it. Now this is actually fixed as a defect report against C++ 14, so it's fixed in C++ 17. At the time I was doing this test, Clang had actually applied that defect report, GCC had not. But GCC released a new compiler last week, so those actually will now pass on GCC. Because they've applied the defect report from C++ 17 to 14. If you're dealing with a broad code base, you need a very modern compiler to expect those versions to work. So, let's const qualify it. Does that change anything? I'm down to 5 minutes, so who thinks it changes something? What's our new bug?
You cannot default construct it if it's const because it has some specified or something?
I can't let it default construct by default. If I explicitly initialize it, that's fine, but I have to explicitly initialize a const, so this line's going to fail, unless I'm compiling with GCC, which doesn't correctly apply the rule here yet. So, how do I fix my tuple? I mean, the whole point of writing the test was to fix a tuple. I have to explicitly write the default constructor, yes. So that's what your actual implementation for an empty tuple should look like. At this point, I got kind of curious to say, okay, I wasn't expecting those things to fail. If I'm now writing generic code, what is the correct way to default construct something or to copy something, because some of these things are failing when I'm not expecting? Which is the safest, most portable syntax to use? So my template can accommodate the most types. While going the other way, I want to make sure my type works with as many algorithm implementations as possible. So for my types, I want to pass all these tests. My type can work with anybody's algorithms. My next set of tests are, I'm implementing an algorithm, which default and copy syntax should I be using to work with the widest variety of types? Eric?
I think Y3 fails in C++ 11.
For this?
Yeah.
Wrong. This passes for everything.
Really?
Yeah. Y3 is simple value initialization using the brace syntax.
No, Y3.
Oh, Y3, sorry. Y3 copying X3, yeah, I'm copying a default, so. That was for aggregates. This is not an aggregate that goes through the aggregate. Eric thinks there's a problem with Y3. I've run this test on GCC and Clang and various versions, and it has never failed once on a compiler that supports the syntax. Likewise, we go const, we know this one fails. What happens if I make the default constructor explicit? This one fails as copy list initialization because I can't make that into a default. So that's X4 out of my portable set of ways to initialize things. Likewise, if I const it, same set. Building my aggregate, I've got that previous class with the funny explicit default constructor. I'll have an aggregate with that as a data member now. Boom. This was with Clang 3.6. These are the ones that failed. And with GCC 4.9.3, it's a completely different set of failures. So I'm out of time, so I'm just going to quickly run through all the slides. Basically, the conclusion is, this was my best bet of syntaxes that work portably across a wide variety of crazy breaking types. Sometimes you want to use the other types if you're looking for the behavior that breaks you might explicitly actually want as part of your contract. But unless you've deliberately thought about it, my recommendation from C++ 11 onwards is always use the form TX3 that wasn't valid before C++ 11. And for the copy constructor, it's the other way. Use the parens.
Don't use C++ at all.
And I've kind of listed the things that cause problems. So, and as a final test, I went through with volatile, and boom, everything fails. Unless I use int. Volatile ints, they all pass. Because class types, you need to have a volatile overload. The fundamental types already have everything they need. So that was an interesting exercise. Just refer to the last slide rather than how we got there. And at that, I'm out of time. with about 3 slides to go. But I think I'll just, any last questions before we conclude?
Okay, what thank are the you. Next 3 slides?
Next 3 slides, traditional advice, avoid breaking changes, C++11 memory model, what did we break? Some compiler optimizations became illegal. In switching to the copy on write, we enabled short string optimizations, which means that begin no longer invalidates iterators. Great result. But swap now invalidate iterators. Maybe less of a result. So we've traded one set of breakages for another in that case. The big concern for me, catching exceptions. If you catch an exception by non-const reference and then enrich it as you're unwinding the stack, you risk getting data races in C++11, because that same exception object could be propagating through multiple threads at the same time, and the synchronization responsibility is now yours. It is a tricky situation to get into, though. Generally, if you control all the code, you know if you're launching other threads, but if you go through some kind of indirection, so you call a virtual function, you call some an overload that could be with a lookup that you don't control, could be something that's specialized by the user, you call any kind of callback, and those might spawn threads and then throw, that idiom is no longer safe. So just as long as you know that you're not calling anything that could result in a separate thread starting and throwing the same exception, you're generally good. But if you're going through any code that the user has the ability to customize, enriching exceptions is no longer a safe idiom. Hence, idiom always referred to catch by const reference. And if you want to do the enrichment thing, use the nested exception facility that will basically just let you chain up additional exceptions. Yeah, so this is my list of things that would be things that you might be doing in your function that could trigger the ability to have a racing exception. And that was the end. Quick takeaways. Document your contracts clearly, because that is the definition of your library. Testing will reveal bad contracts, which you can fix before they get to your users. This is a good thing. As well as broken implementations. Fix the contract or the implementation. If your users haven't seen it yet, you're still in control. If you've released it to your users, they might be relying on the contract and want you to fix the bug. So yeah, it's generally easy to fix the implementation rather than the contract on a live system. Exceptions should not throw copies. Class templates generally want to store data in tuples because it solves so many of those issues that I was trying to solve in one place in tuple. Beware of unexpected ADL. And learn the safe idioms for when you're writing code in templates. And that is the end.